the Spirit has been moving, and it will move. But that day, I can confess to you, I stood up here at this altar in front of the bread and the wine, and all the theology is correct, and we were doing all the correct things, but it just begged to be said, because we were living it out already. I said, you know, this is the body and blood of Christ. It's not my opinion. We believe this. Jesus says, is. This is my body, given for you. And I just said, you know what? This is so sacred that we welcome everyone that Jesus welcomes, and we dare turn away the same people that Jesus turns away from himself. And I was going to stop it right there. And the congregation said, all together, at one time,
No.
I didn't prompt you to do that. That has become a liturgical accepted practice in this gathering. It's become even pastors that come here. I kid you not, they said, can you write that down? It's become, six pastors now have said that. Some from as far away as, oh my gosh, Ohio. And it's not something that was scripted. It's that Jesus is alive and well and active. And we don't have to come up with a mission statement. I mean, not that that's bad. But we see that Jesus is alive. His life is living and breathing. And it's not through our meticulous following of rules. That's fine. That's a good thing. But Jesus is more than just the rules. More than a constitution. More than your history. More than your past. Because I bet there's someone in this room today that wishes they could leave their past way in the past. Well, friends, Jesus' life and love is bigger than whatever you're hauling around with you. And there is a place for you here. And this life is not in our meticulous keeping and excluding of other people. As a matter of fact, here's some examples of this life that Jesus gives. This life that Jesus gives isn't about collecting things that we can wrap up for ourselves and say, yeah, I did this, I served on this committee, and I did God. I'm super Lutheran. No? So what? Who cares? The life that Jesus gives goes outside of the walls. It goes out there. And say, unless you have this life, you really don't have life. Because this life is eternal. It goes on beyond the grave. Think about the people that Jesus calls and says, you know what? I need you to go to this person, this group of people, their senior citizens that love God, and they just, their physical capabilities don't allow them to come to church anymore. Jesus' life is alive in them. Someone goes and picks them up and brings them to church, or goes and visits them because their kids live far away or they're dying from something far away as well. The life of Jesus is characterized in a community of people that go to a school where so many more of the parents are addicted to drugs and the kids are being raised by their grandparents, raised by someone else, and the grandparents are at a loss. They don't even know how to turn on a computer. And the life of Jesus is that body that goes into that community and helps and assists and comes along and walks beside. You see, that is a life that's eternal. It's not something that I can ever script and write down and say, well, this is how Jesus is going to act. It's a truth that we stand and witness. You know, if you're here today, God has called you here today. God has called you to this feast and this community specifically for a purpose. And that purpose, God is going to work out in some way in the future. But know that God is a part of it. Jesus says, come to me all.